Well, those are some of the prints I've done over the years. And you may well ask, what is a bromoil? Well, a bromoil is a piece of paper printed on, preferably on a non-supercoated surface, which is put into a bleach. And the image, three chemicals in the bleach, which affect the gelatine. And the gelatine is hardened in the shadows, but not in the highlights. So when you put it into water and go over the print with a brush, with a very greasy ink, the ink accepts on the shadows, but is rejected from the highlights. Now that sounds simple, and it really is, but it's a knack. It's like riding a bicycle, you get to know how to do it, and you never forget. But how do you start? Well, the first thing you want is a negative. And as I explained earlier on, I go away on my trips on my own usually, and I eat, drink and sleep photography for an entire week. And I go around looking at the kind of subjects that I think will be suitable for the kind of work that I like, which is not difficult. Heavy subjects, as I explained, you know, with strong shadows and the like. Now, to get that kind of negative, you've got to watch out a little bit. Because when you do your negative, sometimes your contrast is too high. So what I invariably do is overexpose at least a stop, and I cut the development. That means that you're going to get a thinner negative, but with everything in the shadows, because the shadows are the difficulty in the type of bromoil that I use. And you say, I specifically say the type of bromoil I use, because there are other types as well, and other people do bromoils different ways. But for the type I want a nice, fully exposed shadow. Right, so we've now got our bleach print, and we hang that up to dry, having thoroughly washed it first, and it's then hung up to dry. And we then finish with a print which there is no visible image, but which has been chemically affected in the shadows and during the course of the process. That's basically what the bromoil consists of. The ink is now applied with a brush. And this is known as a Mortimer brush, because they were invented by F.J. Mortimer. It is F.J. Mortimer, at least I think, my memory fades, I think. Mr. Mortimer, anyway, he invented these brushes. And that is a brush made with hog hairs. Now, they do come in different types and sizes. This is a nylon brush. Now that's one I made myself. You see that it's got a slight slant on the way it's cut. And the idea of that is because you put the brush down, but I'll show you that in a minute. Again, there are other types of brushes. There is a bare hair brush, which is that one. And there's a brush like that, which is worth absolute fortune, which is polecat. They come, as I say, they come in all sizes. That's a little tiny one for filling little holes and that kind of thing. And these are two brushes which I bought some time ago, which I've never cut. These are French paint brushes. How they ink, I don't know. Well, this one I know inks quite well, but it's got a coarser consistency. Now, how to start about it? Well, it all starts, as I say, with a good negative, which I've explained you have to overexpose and underdevelop to get the kind of contrast you want, because the contrast increases as you develop. Or you can keep it fairly low contrast if you want to, but I find that if you want real quality in the shadows, you've got to get ink on. And if you don't put ink on it, it doesn't show properly. Now, so you start off by sorting your subject out, which as I explained is the kind of subject I like, and then overexposing the negative and underdeveloping it. That gives you a flat contrast negative, which is the kind of negative you want for bromoil. You then get hold of a piece of paper, bromide paper, non-supercoated, although I have been told that there are people who do work on supercoated paper, but since I have a stock of the non-supercoated paper, I'm going to use it. It's much easier. And you then, having done your print, I used to develop in amidol, but amidol has a terrible habit. It's very, very fine in texture, and when you weigh it out, you've got to have nothing in the room at all, otherwise it flies all over the place, and when you go to ink your print up, you find you've got black spots on it. So I'd given that up for a bit, although I've got a large stock of amidol. Anybody wants some, but they can have some off me. I now use just ordinary EcuPrint, and I find I get a perfectly decent negative. Now, then I, of course, start with a low contrast negative. I get a low contrast print, and when I put it into soak, I leave it into soak for about... this is where experience comes into it, I suppose. I just stick my finger in and see what kind of temperature it is, and if it's about 65 to 70, well, that's fine. And I leave it in there for about 20 minutes, after which you take it out and you blot it off with blotting paper. I always ink on a sheet of glass. If I need a good firm foundation, they're okay. Then it is really then a question of applying the ink. I take very little ink on the palette to start with, which I've spread out first, and then build up the contrast as I go. Now, if I find that the ink is beginning to take all over, it means that the print is drying out a bit. I then put it back into soak again. Now, the moment you put it back into soak again and start re-inking, you will find your contrast increase, especially if you use a brush like that, which is very hard in contrast and will just bring the ink up quite considerably. There is a trick if you find you can't get your contrast, and that is to ink with a wet brush. Now, if you ink with a wet brush, you can't do it twice, because once you've inked it with a wet brush and you've got water into your print again, you will find the contrast increases so dramatically you just can't do it. Really, it is then a question of soaking, re-inking, soaking, re-inking, till such time as you get your print to your satisfaction. The ink comes in various grades. Having spread it on the palette, I personally use a hard ink and a fairly soft ink, and I mix them together. I then put the brush on the palette. You take a little bit of ink off the palette, and then you transfer it to the print. And you point the point of the brush on the print and lift it up, so. It's not particularly bouncy, but just drag it across. Now, if you find that you're not getting sufficient contrast, you can then bounce your brush more vigorously, and the ink will come off the print and transfer to the shadows. You can then, if you feel you're still getting enough contrast, you can grab it by the brush and really thump it. The paper is... I've never yet been through a piece of paper yet. No trouble at all. So that'll bring the contrast right up. Now, there are other tricks of the trade, of course, which you can do. And, for instance, pencil rubbers are very useful. You can take almost anything out with a pencil rubber, bearing in mind, of course, that you've got white paper base, and then you can retouch it in. But if you do that, you've got to retouch it pretty quick after you've inked it, because once the ink's dried, you will find that if you put ink onto a dry print, it won't be quite the same colour. You can use pencil rubbers, which you can get from artist shops or anything of that nature, and if you want to take a very fine line out, you can just shave the rubber so pointed that you'll just take a little tiny line out, just like a top of a rail or something of that nature. It's worked perfectly okay. So I think that's about all I can tell you about it. There's nothing like seeing it. Damashi, who was a very famous worker, was asked once how to ink a print. And he said, you can't describe it, you've got to see it. So I think that's the best thing I'll do.